really want to thank the Groton Library. Of course, all kinds of institutions are holding some kind of centennial observance. And I'm sure you're aware, I know you're aware here at the Groton Library, that the Connecticut State Library has been trailblazing with its Remembering World War I project, which is effectively augmenting the historical record with ephemera and documents that illustrate the war experiences that are contributed by families around the state. And if you want to learn more about that, I'm sure Michael can talk to you about it after this program. But what's so interesting about that project is they're really doing a history from the ground up, right? The experiences of the individual men and women on the ground. This inspired our newspaper project to try to do something similar, to see what we could contribute with this same approach, to see what newspapers from the period, specifically the ones we're digitizing, the Norwich Bulletin and the Bridgeport Evening Farmer, could do to illuminate the grassroots Connecticut World War I story on the home front. As the president of the State Library, Ken Wigan, wrote in the first press release about our project, newspapers are the first draft of history. The history of the World War I period, as our advisory board insisted when we chose these titles for our first cycle, is inseparable from the history of Connecticut's urbanization, industrialization, the whole period of labor militancy that opened up the century, and a huge demographic shift in Connecticut from a solidly Yankee state to a state where almost half of the population was either foreign-born or their parents were foreign-born. So the two newspaper titles chosen for our project, one a Democratic Party paper that was cited in one of the most advanced industrial centers of Connecticut, a town known as a place where labor and immigrants loomed very large in city politics, that is Bridgeport, and a Republican paper based in a similar town, more of a commercial and banking center and based sited in the rural eastern part of the state, Norwich, offer us then a surprisingly wide window into the various ways that Connecticut residents experienced World War I. In them, I'm pretty certain, and the idea is to encourage you to be part of this, that scholars and local historians are going to discover a wealth of detail that they cannot currently read in any secondary accounts of the home front. There's a lot of work still to be done. And I hope that our discoveries in these newspapers will inspire many of you to dive in and see what you can find. And anything that you find objectionable or not particularly important in my talk, you can remedy by creating your own, talking about the stories you find, and we'd be happy to incorporate blogs and musings of yours on our website as well. Now, what can be expected from these particular titles? Long intro till we get to the pictures. Both papers were guided by their allegiance to one or another set of municipal elites and party leaders, but they were also responsive to much broader audiences. The Bridgeport paper editors, as you'll see when we go through the talk, were determined to win readership among the huge working class and immigrant population in this large industrial town. It was a hotbed of labor management conflict, and it stood out in that respect in the country as a whole. Bridgeport, therefore, was one place on the home front where the war was experienced by large communities of Hungarian, Italian, Czechoslovakian immigrants, and Russian Jews who fled the pogroms in the Tsar's prison house of nations. It was full of working class people who were trained abroad in social democratic ideas, and they were initially very skeptical about the aims of the belligerents in World War I. Naturally, of our two cities, Bridgeport is the place where the World War I era debates on what constituted American, how one defined patriotism, the meaning of democracy, many of their hope for something to come out of the war called industrial democracy. But this is a place where all these debates were very sharply posed. The Norwich paper, on the other hand, looks a little bit like the Wall Street Journal, It was the daily of a town that produced many of the leaders of the relatively hegemonic Republican Party that ran the state government in the land of steady habits. It tended to be the voice of moderation in all things. It also frequently expressed fear that the immigrant population in the state would be disloyal during the war. And both, this is just to give you some images from each of the newspaper. That was a series run in the Norwich Bulletin where they, you know, privileged and celebrated the leading men of industry and finance. And some coverage from the Bridgeport Evening Farmer, who were trying to inoculate the local immigrant population against the dangerous industrial workers of the world who were organizing in the factories. Now, they both were functioning in a very specific context. They were publishing in a state where the initiative for war preparation, the work of the Connecticut Council for Defense specifically, was the first organized in the country, and it was one of the most well-organized state councils in the country. It became a model for the federal government, and the federal government urged other states to emulate Connecticut. The Connecticut Council of Defense was part of the most advanced effort pretty much anywhere in the country to fully mobilize the local population for war. Picture of the Home Guard, which was set up when to fill in for the National Guard when they went abroad to deal with local disturbances in Connecticut, many of which they thought would emanate from the immigrant population. And a calendar of all the events going on, organized by the state month after month as the war carried on. Connecticut carried out a military census to prepare for the war well before the U.S. decided to enter the war. They were proponents of entering the war, and they made lists of all the important industrial, agricultural, and transportation resources of the state, and of every bit of manpower available in the state. They made lists of all the men who could serve in combat, and they made lists of all those who refused to fill out the survey, and they made lists of all the German, Hungarian, Slovak, Russian men between a certain age in every town in the state. The census was seen nationally as the best example of Connecticut's special seriousness about war preparations. At the same time, it was famously critiqued by the dean of the Connecticut Humanities Council, historian of the state politics, Bruce Frazier. Frazier characterized it as stubbornly resistant to Wilsonian moderation and animated by, quote, exaggerated idea of the threat of immigrant and working class revolt in Connecticut's industrial centers. So Connecticut's preparation for the war was born of its centrality as a center of arms production. But this centrality also meant a huge workforce of those soon to be termed enemy aliens by the federal and state governments. James Abramson wrote a book published by the National Defense University in which he explained that preparation for World War I in Connecticut and nationally was shaped by fears that the draft riots of the Civil War might be repeated. Thus, there was, for a time, a great political polarization around the question of U.S. entry into the war, and the debates among the major political players of this period were waged with the same political passion that we're witnessing in the U.S. today. Now, in my selection of articles, I've been guided by first few popular and standard. Let me go back and explain what's here. This is a news article about the military census, how valuable it was in coming up with the list of names for each city of the immigrant workers from Germany, Russia, Poland, Czechoslovakia, etc. This is part of the manpower survey, which, you know, was incredibly complete. All the people who could be appealed to volunteer or eventually drafted for the war. This happens to be one of a group of those who refused, and very close records were kept of those who refused to fill out the survey. And this is an exhibition from a state fair of the results of the encouraging farmers to be part of the agricultural survey. And they did this for every facet of life in Connecticut. So you know where I'm coming from, the way I chose my slides to illustrate these themes, I just relied, I'm not a historian of Connecticut or World War I, so what I did by training, so what I did was rely on the standard histories of the home front. Particularly David Kennedy's Over Here, the First World War in American Society. That's one every college student studying this period is going to look at in the freshman year. And Joseph McCartan's Labor's Great War, which is about how the progressives in the state looked at the war as a chance to reorganize society in a more democratic way, what they thought was a more democratic way. Their goal was to de-Kaiserize industry. Also, John Hingham's Strangers in the Land, which is about the immigration question in this period, Michael Perlman's To Make Democracy Safe for America, which is about the preparedness campaigns, the work of the Connecticut History, you know, Bruce Fraser from the Connecticut History Association, and of course Professor Celia Buckey at Fairfield College, who wrote on Bridgeport in this period. All the articles I'm going to show you are from 1915 to 1920, I think with one exception. And I've inserted photographs because it gets kind of old looking at gray newspaper clippings, and I'd like to enliven it a little bit. So the photos are not necessarily, particularly if you can see them clearly, they're not from the newspapers. There was not much photography in these papers. So I want to open with this slide from the Bridgeport Evening Farmer, Fuel Mob Roundup. It's from the winter of 1917-1918. The headlines read, 1,000s besiege the fuel office. 4 women become hysterical and are taken to the hospital. 50,000 workers fear being thrown on the street. Another headline, frenzied housewives tear down fences at McGee's coal yard. McGee fled the mob of women. Police restored order, the newspaper says. Bins bare, babe in plaster, suffers in cold. Another woman, in heart-rending tones, tells the reporter of the suffering she and her children have endured for 4 weeks without cold in the most frigid winter on record. Other woman, who stood from, the stories tell us, stood from dawn to dusk, wept when denied cold. These articles reflect the local Bridgeport experience, and it very likely occurred here, though I can't say that with any certainty, that accompanied the great coal crisis of the first winter of the war here at home. The shortages, which occurred during an attempt to centralize fuel distribution in the midst of this especially cold winter and war mobilization, that was blamed on the Wilson administration and interference in the market by the Republicans. It was blamed on greedy, incompetent railroads and shippers by the Democrats. It was based on national inexperience with the level of logistics required pretty much by everybody else, and in hindsight. To deal with the crisis, the railroads were finally nationalized a month after this article in order to try to break up the blockade, the inability to have transportation working. I mean, this wasn't just a question of households, of course, it was industry and factories as well that were threatened by this. So I start with this just to suggest that across the board, for those who were suffering the coal shortage, and of course it was most severe among the lower income people, it must have felt for a few weeks as if the war had really come home at the end of 1917. Now, advanced preparation for entering the European war was urged by those who were in the support of the U.S. taking on the burdens of empire, so to speak, began long before the majority supported U.S. entry into the European war, and when isolationism was very much the majority sentiment in the United States. This is a picture of the Plattsburgh camp. Part of the non-official preparation was initiated by Teddy Roosevelt and General Leonard Wood, the leaders of the Rough Riders campaign into Cuba in the Spanish-American War. Roosevelt and Wood led a private, citizen-based movement calling for universal military training in the hopes that the U.S. would enter into the European War. It was called the Plattsburgh Movement. They saw universal military training as a way to purify the nation, a go-go business nation that they thought had succumbed to moral and spiritual and physical degeneration. They saw both immigrants coming in for higher wages and Wall Street bigwigs as equally equally burdened by materialism. And they thought that this was in need of attention. So it was a great moral crusade, not only a practical one. As the official leadership of the U.S. military did not support universal military training, they set up this private camp. The Plattsburgh Movement was supported strenuously by the presidents of the big universities in Connecticut, such as Yale and other elite colleges like Harvard, and they had said they wanted to recoup their role as moral guardians for the nation, something they had to relinquish when they became secular institutions. Now, the Norwich Bulletin published many accounts, and certainly family historians and others will be interested. They published many accounts of the battles going on at Plattsburgh as part of the regular weekly news. They published a lot of these stories on the society pages because these were the sons and husbands of prominent businessmen, Yale University students, whatever. And you get a little sense of the cachet of being part of the Plattsburgh Movement by looking at this advertisement here on the right. It says, the ace of the season, he's going to be wearing the Plattsburgh. So you see him in his boater hat, and this high fashion men's clothing is associated with the preparedness movement. And if you're really, and they think that's going to boost sales significantly. Perhaps one of the things that worried the Plattsburgh supporters was the early attitude of much of labor toward military training. In the pre-war period, much of the labor movement in Connecticut was very hostile to joining military units. This is an editorial from the Bridgeport Evening Farmer, and they're chastising the labor movement and the pro-labor socialist party in Connecticut. They're saying, because they promised to expel any workers who joined the state militia. And so that Bridgeport's chastising them, but they're saying, if you really want to get workers to join the state militia, you got to quit letting the industry use the state militia to break up strikes. So this is sort of the atmosphere in which the government is considering, how are we actually going to mobilize for World War? So given that atmosphere, imagine how industry is responding. Bridgeport industrialists began to make huge profits from war orders well before the U.S. entered the war from many of the belligerent powers in Europe. And they were afraid that negative public opinion about the war would impact them. Here is an article basically from 1915 that discusses their public relations efforts. It says, an unusual form of entertainment was given at the UMC plant to its employees. Three orchestras on as many floors, quantities of cigars for the men, ice cream for the for all. It gave pleasure to between 5,000 and 7,000 employees. There was dancing, vaudeville entertainment, and one of the features it notes, importantly, was the fact that good fellowship existed between the officials of the company and the employees of the various nationalities that participated in the pleasure. Whether or not this PR was necessary, Bridgeport soon developed into what the New York Times called the Essen of America. That is, it was Mars Workshop. It was the place of, you know, a significant percentage of munitions for the war were produced there. Her booming industry, much of it munitions, brought labor from all over the East Coast. And especially immigrants would take the train from New York City to Bridgeport to work in the factories. One of the phenomena that got Connecticut a lot of national attention in 1915 was a great uprising of working women, many in non-traditional jobs in Bridgeport. In August of 1915, just after that PR event happened and the Dancing and Cigars for All, women played a key role in a massive general strike in Bridgeport. Newly confident because of the abundance of higher paid factory work that came into existence with arms production, the women are said to have outshone the traditionally organized skilled male workforce in their determination to get a shorter work week. That would have been a 48-hour work week, organizing not only at the big machine shops like the UMC, but out at the laundries. It was a boom town of guys in tenements, so laundries, you know, serviced, you know, tens and tens of thousands of people, the restaurants and the retail shops. The unexpected appearance on the stage of these young women, many of whom were teenagers, immigrant women, very young, some older, of course, as well, is recorded in fascinating detail in the Bridgeport papers, and anybody who's interested in this sort of thing will be amazed, because or if you're a family historian, it lists hundreds of names and conversations in every mass meetings in five languages and marches and meetings down the streets and so forth. I mean, it's an amazing contribution to, like, grassroots history in Connecticut. Now, when later the Council of Defense organized to send women into the factories, but their aim was primarily, and you can see by the little drawing here, their aim was primarily to organize middle-class women to go in and participate in war production. And when they did this, those other women kind of thought that they were being sent in possibly, potentially, as strike breakers or somehow to dilute their union power. So there was a lot of skepticism about this on the ground, though today we see a lot of posters and, you know, we don't exactly know how it might have been received fully. So while the Minutemen and some of these middle-class women organized to go into the factories were viewed somewhat skeptically, clearly the suffragists were not. This is a big story. Working women favor votes for women. The organizers of the machinists in Bridgeport were the ones who raised the money to send these women to Washington for a lot of the big picket lines and to take these immigrant women with them to the pickets for suffrage in D.C. How well you can see that, but that's a kind of an iconic photograph of the women picketing for suffrage at the White House and, you know, saying it's very nice to fight for democracy abroad, but what about getting it here for women as well? It's a good introduction to this. I want to talk about one week in Bridgeport and the kind of public rallies that occurred there and what everybody was doing. Just one week in March at a very critical point in the war effort in Europe. Here you see, at the time where these pickets in Washington were still quite controversial, Dudley Malone, I can tell you who he is later if you like, he was the featured speaker in the town. He spoke, you know, appropriated military language to defend the suffragists who were in jail, put in jail by Wilson, suffrage over the top of the trench. And this meeting was quite interesting because you can read all the accounts. I'm sure it happened all over the state. This is just one city. It was very interesting because at the end, they unanimously called for a new trial for Tom Mooney. Now, who was Tom Mooney? He was like a radical labor organizer in California who was actually falsely accused, it turns out, but had been accused of planning a bomb and a preparedness campaign. He was so clearly framed up that President Wilson was part of his defense team. And there's big editorials in the papers, depending if it was Democrat or Republican. Here, a Democratic paper saying, Tom Mooney is a labor leader. It would be a crime. It would be a danger to the war effort to execute him. He should be released. And they say the interest of the country and of property requires the pardon of Mooney. It's not the time to execute a working man. That is, they call on industry not to break the unity that's required in the middle of a war by demanding something that would be so abhorrent to labor. Same time, same week, there were giant mass rallies, a monster war rally led by an important cleric for draftees with 1A, thousands would attend. Another major rally where the four Minutemen, of course, along with other government volunteers who were promoting support for the war, would speak. I think what's interesting about this is we sometimes get a very one-dimensional view about what life was like on the home front, but here you can see that in a town, an industrial town, central to the war effort, there were all these sort of contending visions about what patriotism was, what democracy was, what supporting the war effort really was, and it was a lively public discourse about the war. This discourse, public support for the war, really consolidated pretty much around February 1917. Not completely, because these other events happened as well, but in part it was because of the Zimmerman telegram. You may remember that from college or high school history, but in February, there was a telegram published in February of 1917 that showed Germany making post-war plans with Mexico. That is right on the U.S. border. And so more and more, felt more imminent, felt more like a danger at home, and more Connecticut residents came to support U.S. entry into the war. Now, progressive era reformers hoped that support to the war would lead the government to lead industry to accept government regulation of the factories. That is, that they would control wages and hours and working conditions, and that this would lead to a new, more progressive America. and many of the social democratic immigrant communities came to support the war, even though they were initially skeptical as social democrats of capitalist war, thinking it was just for business profits. They came to support it when they realized that the war would defeat the Austro-Hungarian Empire, these empires that were made oppress their own aspiring nations inside Europe. So they came to support the war to support the independence of their homelands. Other parts of the population, and you can read all about this in the newspaper, the business pages, came to believe there were tremendous gains to be made for U.S. trade, especially in Latin America and Asia, if the U.S. played a combat role at this late point in the war, and that would give them an independent seat at the peace table, which would be, redividing the colonies and so forth. So, in some measure, this shift from isolationism to support for intervention was due, well, to a great degree, to the work of the Connecticut Council of Defense. And the head of a federal propaganda effort, what was called the federal propaganda effort, basically, George Creel. He was a journalist and a publicist, and he was assigned to win the battle for hearts and minds to support the war by persuasion. And he was the head of creating a whole series of official war films that were shown all over Connecticut in the movie theaters. This is the second United States official war film, America's Answer. And then the Minutemen would come and speak before these films explaining what was important about the war. What historians think is important here is that there was a choice made by the Wilson administration to use persuasion, not repression, as a way to build up patriotic sentiment and get people to intervene in the war. Even by today's advertising standards, this effort seems really incredible. This is another film that was shown all over Connecticut, an official war film. Ask your teacher, and he comes, this diplomat comes and talks about what Prussian culture and politics are really like. So it's an effort to explain why Germany must be defeated. These are just pictures of some of the Minutemen from Bridgeport. There were volunteers from all over the state, trained by the state, who had prepared talks that were federally produced and state produced, and they would go out and speak, usually businessmen and leaders of the town, and they would go out and speak and win people, answer questions and win people to the war effort. The state also, of course, organized the Liberty Bonds campaigns, you know, giant effort to raise funds for the war, and these would run in the newspapers, and they would be sponsored by, you know, different industries, particularly industries that were involved in war production. They would go door to door. This one's interesting because this company, International Textile, was actually confiscated in the middle of the war because its owners were German, and its workers were all Hungarian. It's an interesting story. I'll tell you about it sometime. And of course, there was the Victory Garden campaign. We always think about that for World War II, but it was very prominent in World War I. There were Victory Gardens outside every factory. There were Victory Gardens outside the schools. That any spare land in a city, you know, people were urged to be part of growing for the state. I don't think this 50,000 mobilization of children ever happened, but it was on the agenda, you know, before the war ended. Food conservation, of course, was considered a major military obligation. You know, there was constant education about alternatives to using wheat, which was needed abroad. You know, bakers were making victory bread. Even cartoons like this would draw home the lesson that you have to conserve in order to send food abroad for those in combat. And you see a little cartoon, kid giving up his sugar. There were constant campaigns to increase the yield of the victory gardens to produce food. there's many interesting stories about this. People had very utopian hopes for this as well. They thought perhaps we would end hunger after the war because we all learned how to create victory gardens. But of course, it didn't really quite work out that way. But nonetheless, it was a precedent for World War II. And people still look at it today as how we could have urban gardens, for example. Some of the ways of encouraging people to conserve were a little more lighthearted. Wool was needed for the war effort, so women were encouraged to wear silk. Now, not everything was persuasion. There was censorship. Radical newspapers and magazines were not allowed to go through the mails. A librarian in Bridgeport, who was in charge of censoring German books in the library that might be in German or might be seen as somehow sympathetic to German history, for example, and he belonged to this group of intellectuals called the Vigilantes, and they would organize to purge the libraries, to monitor writings and so forth, expose pro-German sentiment if they could see it. Mostly, you know, what you see in the papers is, of course, just a celebration of those who are actually going into combat. This is actually an ad for a grocery store, it's a store owned by the Davy family, and they encourage people to use their store. They celebrate the fact that their sons are part of serving to beat the Hun in France. For some people, the war was fun and games, thrills, a way to get out of home and leave. This is a pretty famous teenage, a young woman from Bridgeport who searched all over to begin to find a way to get abroad and eventually got training to be a nurse and served in the war. It was also a time for invention. Here's just one of many stories about a chemist at the American Gramophone Company in Connecticut, who figured out how to replace raw materials from Germany and create a new way to produce records. Overall, you know, there are just hundreds and hundreds. There were activities every day in every city, multiple times a day. It was a full-out campaign to carry out conservation, produce food, raise money. Support the war effort, primarily organized through the State Council of Defense. Now, I grew up in the Vietnam War era, so this kind of shocked me the first time I saw it. slackers in the Shoestring District. They kept lists if people didn't show up at the draft board. Slackers, and they even used non-official volunteer organizations like the American Patriotic League, Protective League, to like kind of go out and look for people who refused to enlist for the draft, and they published long lists of people's names town by town, and it was a powerful, you know, way peer persuasion, you might say. This didn't just happen though in terms of the draft. This is about the campaign to win housewives to conservation of food. And they go door, they explain, this is in Norwich, they're going door to door, and you have to you're asked to sign a pledge, you'll conserve these foods. And if you do sign the pledge, you get to put that sticker in your window. And if you don't, you go on a list. And it says, those who refuse to sign are pro-German. So, you know, there was the slacker campaigns involved not only those going into combat, but were a tool that were used sometimes not necessarily officially. There was kind of this tension between what the government actually organized to happen and what zealous citizens felt should happen. The historians call it the tension between volunteerism and coercive patriotism, or volunteerism and vigilanteism, because when you're in a full mobilization like this and people are authorized to make sure everybody carries their own burden and toes the line, good things can happen, bad things can happen. I wanted to show you a few of the efforts to actually win immigrant workers to the war. This is a very, Reverend Stephen Weiss was a very famous Hungarian rabbi and intellectual leader in the United States. He and his son went to work in the shipyard in Stamford in order to be there and talk to the workers about why they should be supporting the war. Many immigrant communities, once it became clear that their homelands could be liberated out of World War I, joined up with their home armies. That is, the U.S. government allowed them to leave and join like independent sort of liberation armies in Europe. One of the ones that got a lot of press in Connecticut was the Czechoslovak War League, and these are Czechoslovak army units in Russia on the Eastern Front. And a lot of money was raised for them in Bridgeport, and I'm sure that this sort of thing happened all over, but for those family historians, recognize that this fundraising and all this work, immigrant community by immigrant community, was much celebrated in the papers, and you're going to find a lot of stories by functioning that. I can't explain. It's a very convoluted story, the Czechoslovak League, but it is one example of the way one immigrant community mobilized in Connecticut. Now, not everybody had a chance to prove, not every immigrant group had a chance to prove their loyalty to the war by enlisting. Germans, Hungarians, Russians, those who were from nations deemed enemy nations were classified before the war started as enemy aliens. And there were actually quite extraordinary things that a lot of those families lived through. There were 55 German-born residents. First males, then females were registered. German immigrant groups with constitutions or mission statements that included like social democratic language, like they oppose capitalist war, or they oppose war for business, or something like that. That was deemed, as long as that existed, it was deemed disloyal utterance, and that became illegal under the Alien and Sedition Acts. So this story is about, says, a bartender who was part of this group was talking to a policeman and explaining that of course they weren't supposed to join in war. And this is a local fluff on a story that the federal agents deemed that this mutual aid society, because of this constitution, was engaged in disloyal utterance. And they rounded up several hundred in Connecticut and thousands in the rest of the country. It's hard to get a feel like what was this really like on the ground in your town, but there are things to begin to give you a feel for that, that besides family stories. This is an ad for a film, to get you to come, it says, we've advised people who go to this picture to instantly report anybody that doesn't cheer and clap at the right places. If they make unfriendly or seditious remarks, we want you to write it down. We want you to take notice. We must crush the enemy within our gates. See the picture. If you want to smoke them out, you can come to this movie and be part of that project. So it's good to recognize that, you know, this kind of stuff did go on. I raise this when I go to History Day and I just show a lot of slides to teachers, and honestly, so many teachers, the stuff about, well, exploring what happened to German Americans in that period is very interesting to them. So many people come up and say, oh, my grandfather or my, you know, said, somebody came and said, he never understood why he couldn't play on the playground, you know, and then he found out years later that his teacher was, you know, decided that the German American students couldn't play on the playground and that kind of thing. So I think it's one of those sort of traumas, you know, that a group goes through and it's embarrassing and you don't talk about it for many years. But maybe this centennial, you know, it's a time to air those stories and talk about what that experience was really like for this pretty large part of the population. There was also, you know, specific laws, particularly probably here, I don't know the specifics here, but any place where there was military production in the shoreline, they basically created exclusion zones. So if you were an enemy alien, Hungarian, Polish, Russian, whatever, you weren't allowed to go there except with a little card maybe to go to work, but you weren't allowed to be in there at other times. Families who lived there were moved out. And there's stories where they try to move people out, but they don't have anywhere to put them, so they let them stay a few more days, and then they find some place that maybe they can be hosted for a while. And so this is a picture running in the paper. It's kind of a warning. It says a sign. This is a national picture, you know, that was syndicated picture. Enemy aliens, they have to watch their step. You got to get your card. You got to stay out of the areas that are cordoned off. And these could be someplace like Norwich or Bridgeport. It's an awful lot of the town, right? And obviously this caught up a lot of people, right, who had no disloyal intentions. This is a story about Benjamin, Brian, and Paul Pulaski, who had their pass cards, and they got their cards, and they were legal, but it says they were arrested and interned. I don't know if they actually were interned, but they were arrested for internment because it said that it secured their papers, but an investigation disclosed they'd entered restricted zones, they had attended theaters, and generally gone about the city on Sundays. This change must have been so shocking because this is from 1910. German Americans were like the perfect minority, right? The most lauded immigrant population in Connecticut. The governor went to all the big choral celebrations and so forth, and then just, you know, less than, you know, 7 years later, you know, they have these cards, and it must have been a shocking experience for those who were totally, who were loyal. There was, you know, another very famous incident in Connecticut, another moment of the war where there were repressive measures taken was called the Palmer Raids, where workers in the Russian, it was called the Russian Workers Union, which most, you know, these things are all debated because they're political, right? So everybody debates what was really true. Most historians say that this group was just a social group, but the federal government thought that they would be, see, this is November 1917, 1919, the Russian Revolution had happened in 1917, October 1917. The Council of Defense thought that workers might rise up and make a revolution here. And these they swept in before the anniversary of the Russian Revolution and arrested these Russian workers all over, but Bridgeport, Ansonia, Derby, all the industrial centers, basically. This one's just, article's interesting because it says most of the men are factory hands, you know. And they were interned, they were imprisoned in Hartford. There were trials. There's big accounts of this. You can read about it if it interests you. Most of them were deported on this ship, the Buford, called the Soviet Ark. It included famous anarchists and all kinds of people like Emma Goldman and so forth, as well as these guys, you know, these guys from the shop, basically, down the street. Now, this was pretty quickly recognized by society as large, as a not well thought out operation and an improper act. This is the secretary, assistant secretary of labor challenged this in Connecticut and other places. It was basically dismissed as an unwise excess of the war. He wrote the famous book, The Deportations Delirium, of 1919, and a lot of it's about what happened in Connecticut, and it'll be fairly interesting for you because it comes up fairly often in discussions about this period and other periods. One of the Connecticut homefront events that makes national histories of this period is the effort of Bridgeport machinists to strike to prevent skill dilution in the midst of the war. Now, a lot of these guys were the skilled workers, right, that had their own tools, who, you know, felt themselves essential to production. And the way they saw it was that the munitions companies were making a killing, you know, there were tremendous war profits, but instead their jobs were being de-skilled. You know, a kind of mass production was occurring under in order to speed up war production. And of course, they felt that they weren't getting the benefits of the war production. And in fact, when they came out of the war, that they would not be skilled workers anymore. So they struck. And here, this is a front page story from the Bridgeport Evening Farmer. The federal government directly intervened. President Wilson said, if you don't go back to work, you will be banned from working any employment for a year and you will be drafted. They ignored this. So of course it was rather, was big news. The government came in and offered them a pretty generous settlement, which they didn't take. And there were all sorts of appeals to them, you know, by other unionists and stuff, saying, you know, go back to work, fight after the war, etc. So what was the hope? The hope of them, this layer of people in the labor movement, was that what they called reconstruction, that is the reorganizing of the economy after the war, would be based on what the government had done in the plants during the war, that there would be shop committees, workers would be consulted. They did all kinds of things to keep production going without any break. And they hoped that this would be what would happen. Instead, you know, there was a different unfolding. Just 2 months after that strike, where the machinists were threatened with, you know, the draft or going back to work, the war ended. And instead of worrying about whether you were a skilled worker or an unskilled worker, in fact, there was massive close down of the factories. They tried to not make it abrupt, but it was still very dramatic, huge losses of jobs. The head of that machinist union was in this atmosphere, was, you know, wrote a pamphlet called "Won a War, Lost a Job." But it was considered a subversive pamphlet, and he was arrested for handing it out. The soldiers who were returning came back in this period of, like, massive unemployment. So there were all kinds of special efforts to figure out what to do with them, how to find them a job. You have, like, local committees, all the associations, the Daughters of the American Revolution, all the war committees, trying to find jobs for them. Maybe war gardens was the way to go, et cetera. So it's very interesting. I don't think it's been fully explored. I only found a few articles, but I think it really deserves attention. And then, of course, these are the same veterans, you know, that, you know, a decade later become the bonus marchers and march on Washington demanding a lump sum payment to help get them through the Great Depression. naturally, the newspapers, you know, they're invaluable for understanding how those who were returning were honored, how their experiences were digested by the civilian population. Remember, during the war, a lot of the news from the front was blacked out, right? Those were security questions. So in the papers after the war, you begin to find the stories, you know, of groups of local soldiers and what they experienced. And the population can begin to absorb how extreme their experiences were, and so they could properly honor their heroism. And this is just one of those many stories, how Bridgeport men took the famous hill 378. And those who are interested in the local records, of course, there's all sorts of different manuscript collections and military records that can be looked at, but I think it's interesting to see what the general population was reading about their experience and how that prepared people to do the memorials and so forth for the war. Now, the one group whose combat experience wasn't recognized as heroic were the black veterans. A lot of times they weren't allowed to go into combat. They were kept into cleaning brigades and things like that. Those who did fought under French leadership. And, you know, W.E.B. Du Bois famously rushed to France right after the war to collect stories about how the black troops functioned to combat this idea that they weren't good soldiers. Issued a big report and then encouraged them to use their war experience to fight for civil rights in the United States. And this is in Connecticut. This group organized in 1919. I've been researching this. They pretty much submitted a bill for non-discrimination in public accommodations every year since the Plessy versus Ferguson Act in 1896. But in 1919, it had a particular resonance and was captured in the papers because they had J.L. Morgan, a colored land, wounded 7 times in France, bearing decorations, the French cross. He appeared and said, you know, we've demonstrated our commitment to this country. We've demonstrated, you know, our patriotism, our strength, our frugality. It's time to grant us finally desegregate public accommodations in Connecticut. That meant restaurants, hospitals, et cetera. It didn't happen then, of course. But nonetheless, it was sort of a very important moment, I think, in Connecticut history, where much more of the population sort of became aware that, in fact, public accommodations remain segregated in the state. Reconstruction, and what happened in terms of Reconstruction? What happened with the economy immediately after the war? I'm showing you 2 images, one to sort of stand for the Jazz Age, the Roaring Twenties, which you remember was this period of tremendous economic boom. The U.S., you know, gained a lot in terms of its global stature, in terms of trade, and so forth, out of the war. And local manufacturing, you know, was working very hard to recover profitability, if they weren't in munitions or war-producing things, they need to recover profitability. And instead of going for this idea of Reconstruction, they went for the idea of the open shop. The National Manufacturers Association went on a national campaign called the American Plan to make sure to kick the unions out of the shops. And this resulted in a pretty dramatic downturn in wages. So the Roaring Twenties were a very economically profitable period. But it didn't lift all boats. Now, let's just think for a minute, you know, this talk is supposed to be about what did the war mean on the home front for women, for immigrants, for the black community, et cetera, in addition to those who served. So what did it really mean? And historians are pretty much agreed on this. So you didn't get industrial democracy. For all intensive purposes, the Palmer raids and things like that pretty much eliminated the radical labor movement, you know, the Socialist Party, the IWW. They pretty much went out of existence through all that post-war campaigns. And the open shop campaign pretty much reduced wages, and it broke up the shop committees and all the things that were set up by Wilson, by the federal government. Women's suffrage was, one, put into law in 1920 because you couldn't deny the role that women had played in the factories, as nurses, overseas, etc. I mean, that was pretty much a slam dunk. But the entrance of women into these factories in these skilled, in these jobs like the Bridgeport women in 1915, that was turned around. And you weren't gonna, you didn't see that again at that level until they were needed again in World War II. Black troops gained a lot of self-confidence and they launched a civil rights campaign, but at the same time, their presence in US, official US uniforms, cocky, confident, et cetera, provoked a huge backlash, a huge racist backlash in the United States. It was known as the Red Summer, where there was the largest number of racial, extra-legal violence, riots, and often against these black soldiers that had occurred since, you know, since the Reconstruction period. In general, immigrants, they under those who served, they underwent Americanization. Many of them, you know, it was really eased their integration into American society. But remember that the war also led to the 1924 National Origins Act, which was the main, remember, millions and millions of Connecticut, between 1890 and the war, Connecticut became almost 50% immigrant or the children of immigrants. 1920, and that was mostly, that era was mostly immigrants from Southern and Eastern Europe. In 1924, that door was shut. The National Origins Act decided who could be let in based on what country, and they privileged Northern Europe. So that was a dramatic shift in terms of the open door policy, basically. The first official memorializing of the war, still really rooted in the passion of the combat and the huge sacrifices that had been made, understandably focused on the returning troops and their families who had lost members in combat. And it naturally smoothed over this diversity of experiences that we're talking about here today. But I think now, you know, 100 years later, we can begin to understand the different ways that those who had fought on the front, those who had been on the home front, who fought in production, who maybe were low income and faced special sacrifices on the home front, and those who were treated as enemy aliens, we can put that into the package. We can understand that this was a very complex experience and that all of our families and ancestors, you know, experienced it in different ways, and we need to acknowledge all of it. Now, one of the most inspiring outcomes, I think, was a revitalization of the fight for free speech around the country and in Connecticut. This is a story, you remember during the war, disloyal utterance, you couldn't stand on a street corner, hand out a flyer. That was illegal. This is from 1920. As soon as the war was over, combat was over, Palmer raids were over and discredited, people organized and took to the streets to try to reestablish their right to be on the street corner. And this is a free speech fight. They happened all over Connecticut, but this is a story of one in Connecticut. This is an image of one of the people who volunteered to go stand on the corner and get arrested to make a new test case. Her name was, she was a fairly wealthy person, Elizabeth Glendow Evans. She was from Brookline, Mass., and she was accompanied by someone from the Socialist Party and somebody from the American, newly formed American Civil Liberties Union. And the police came and arrested them, as expected, so they could have their test case. But that wasn't the end of it. Thousands of people gathered, 1,000 men, women, and children marched with them to a big hall, you know, to celebrate, you know, this effort and support them and try to reestablish things that had been lost, necessarily or unnecessarily. That's a historical and political opinion, to reestablish free speech now that at the end of the war.